Well, welcome to our midweek Bible study here at Grace Church, and we are continuing a verse-by-verse study through the book of Colossians. Still have a few weeks that we'll finish up the book, but we're just taking this in small pieces and going through it verse-by-verse, and we're going to continue today in Colossians chapter 3. Now, as I've done for several weeks, by way of reminder, it's always helpful to remember where we are at in the book of Colossians. And at the outline that I have kind of reviewed each week of the entire book, it's only four chapters. And chapters one, Paul is dealing with the truth about Christ. Remember, he's addressing some false teaching that is going on in the church of Colossae. Colossae was a town just southeast of Ephesus. And so this is in modern-day Turkey. This was in the seven churches that are mentioned in Revelation 2 and 3. Colossae is not one of those, but it's in that area. And so he's addressing false teaching. So again, false teaching about the person of Christ and how a person relates to Christ, what its true spirituality is. So in chapter 1, he's addressing the truth about Jesus Christ. In chapters 2, he is addressing the truth about the cults. He gets a little bit more specific into the false teaching there at Colossae. And then in chapters 3 and 4, having built a foundation on doctrine, he gets into the outworking, the so what practicality. And so chapters 3 and 4 is the truth about the Christian life. So that's where we're at. We're going to be in Colossians 3, 20 and 21 today. And just in that context, remember how chapter 3 begins. Remember, this is a transition from the doctrinal aspect. I mean, it's all doctrinal, but the teaching about Christ and the false teachers and what true spirituality looks like. So based upon that, remember how chapter 3 begins. He says in chapter 3, verse 1, if then, in other words, based on all the truth that has gone previous to that, if then you are raised with Christ, seek those things which are above, where Christ is sitting at the right hand of God. Set your mind on things above, not on things of the earth. So that's kind of a hinge, you know, like a door has a hinge. That's a hinge statement where Paul now goes into another room. The door opens and he goes into another room and he gives some practical instruction of what does this mean based on what he's taught. So won't, again, review everything we've done, but last week we looked at the practicality of these truths, and he addresses in verse 18 about wives, and verse 19, husbands, and now he's dealing with children and parents, and then he'll deal with servants and masters. Really, this is the whole household of what composed a first century household, and he's dealing with the whole home environment here. And so now he moves in verse 20. That's where we'll start out. Verse 20 says, children, obey your parents in all things, for this is well-pleasing to the Lord. Now keep in mind, these were letters written by the apostle, and they were maybe copied, but initially there was a few copies, if that, but they were circulated and publicly read in the churches, whether they were, most of them were meeting at this time in homes. There certainly wasn't favorability of building large assembly rooms or whatever. They were meeting in homes, gathering. But what I want you to notice is that if this is a letter being written and spoken and read out loud to a corporate gathering, whether it was 15 or 50 or 100, whatever it was, notice what Paul makes an assumption here. He addressed wives, husbands, but he assumes that the children are in the assembly, that children are going to hear. They have already sat through 2.5 chapters. Of course, they didn't have chapters then, but they have already sat through the teaching of Paul. So when he addresses children, Paul is naturally assuming that children are going to hear this being read and that they are going to be there. Just a little tip there on parents who don't think bringing your children to church, yes, even making your children come to church is wisdom. I disagree with that. Children should be with their parents in church, and we make accommodation for that. Ideally, we want them to be in the larger setting, because what happens is, and you see this with a lot of churches, they grow up in a children's church and go to a youth group, and then they come into adult church, big church, they can't handle it because balls aren't being thrown around, and the music is, and there's no fog machines, and there's no videos, and constant stimulus, and there's not a snack and juice. And so we've kind of raised them in an entertainment environment instead of letting them learn what it means to sit under the Word of God, to hear worship and to engage in worship. Train your children for adult church. We do adult church at Grace Church, okay? That's free. But I love that Paul just assumes children are going to hear what he's saying here. And he says, really in a companion verse in Ephesians 6:1, children, obey your parents in the Lord, for this is right. So children is kind of a general term for children. It's not necessarily a specific age that he's mentioning here. And he says, children, obey. The word obedient is a continuous obedience. So he's saying that children ought to continually obey their parents. Remember what Paul is doing here. He is setting the husband up in this home and structure. He's the captain of the team. Wives, submit to your husbands. That's a voluntary role that she has. It's kind of God's ranking in the home. We are equal in Christ, but just like in other structures, we have different roles. We are equal, just maybe to use an analogy in our nation, we are all equal Americans, but we all obviously have different roles and different rankings in the society and culture. Well, in the church, there is a different roles that we have of elders and deacons and different leadership roles. And then we have, certainly there's leadership roles that God has placed in the home. Husbands, in the ideal home situation, husbands are the captain of the team, and wives, because it's pleasing to the Lord, the Bible says in that verse, and they submit, not because the husband maybe is smarter, better, but because that is the structure God has placed in the home. Now, any smart husband is going to certainly know and admit that their wives play a very prominent leadership role in the home. That would be foolish. But this structure naturally goes from husbands, wives, and now he's addressing children. Of course, you know the Bible, Ten Commandments continually talk about children, honoring your father and your mother. That is in the scripture. Exodus 20:12, part of the Ten Commandments. There were some very strict punishments for children and rebellion in the Old Testament. I'm glad those are not enforced today. I probably would not be here, okay? But striking a parent was punishable by death in the Old Testament. Disobedience was dealt with severely. Children not listening and obeying their parents' instruction was, again, something very strictly dealt with. It's interesting in that catalog of sins in Romans 1:30, when he's giving this description of the depravity and sinfulness of man on the earth, one of the characteristics that he mentions in chapter 1:30 of Romans is that children in this depraved, fallen world, in this rebellion, exhibits itself in a rebellion or disobedient to parents. And we have certainly seen cultures and generations where this has been festered in our culture. I think with the change in the 60s and the rebellion that has occurred in the 60s, we are now dealing with leaders and really children of those rebels who rebelled against authority structures in the 60s. Now we are seeing their children in places of government and offices and leadership, and we as a culture see the effects of that rebellious mindset. But so children are to obey their parents. That's very straightforward by the Apostle Paul. Now, obviously, like in other cases with wives, and I didn't spend a lot of time in this, I kind of left that out last week when I was talking about wives submitting to their husbands. One thing I don't think I mentioned or bore down enough was that anytime that it's a test between God's word and obeying man, whether it's a husband or a parent, God's word, God's law for the Christian always takes precedent. And that's true for a wife, is not to obey a husband who would ask her to do something that violates her conscience before the Lord, or even violates the law. If he wants her to engage in some Ponzi scheme and steal money from her employer or whatever, her obedience, first and foremost, is to God. Well, children in the same way, they're to obey their parents, but not if their parent is asking them to disobey God's word. So being obedient to parents is well-pleasing to the Lord. And so one of the things that we see here next is Paul gives a word to parents, okay? He's dealt with wives, husbands, children, and now he goes to fathers. But really in the Hebrew, it is better, the word in the Greek rather, comes from, is the word patreas, which means fathers, but really should be translated parents, as it is in Hebrews 11:23. So he says, fathers, parents, do not provoke your children lest they become discouraged. The NIV says, do not embitter your children. The New Living Translation says, do not aggravate your children. And it says that don't do it lest they become discouraged or lose heart, breaking the child's spirit. Thankfully, I did not have a mother and father or parental figures that did that. I mean, they certainly disciplined me, sometimes as a full-time job, but they did not break my spirit, okay? I might have been discouraged because of their discipline, but they did not break my spirit. Now, there are several ways that I want to conclude on how parents can cause their children to lose heart, to be discouraged, to become embittered. This is something not original with me. These are just 10 things I want to go over that I saw from John MacArthur in his commentary on Colossians that I thought, hey, that's good, and I want to share that with you. We'll just go through these pretty quickly in the final minutes that we have, but here is several ways parents negatively can cause their children to lose heart, to become discouraged. Number one, parents can provoke their children by overprotection. They've got rules about everything. They allow their children no liberty. Obviously, there's correct rules and guidelines, but this is kind of a overbearing, overprotection. And so I think it's good for parents to communicate why you can't do this, why this is a rule. But at the same time, I think as children grow, there's a certain amount of freedom and testing. If they can't handle that, well, then we won't give you that freedom. But an overprotection. Secondly, is parents provoke their children by showing favoritism. You know, I thought about the life of Joseph. I thought about Jacob and favoring Joseph. That created some rivalry there with his brothers. But this can be something very unwittingly done. Sometimes it's deliberately done. And so a child who may not enjoy that favor with the parent can kind of feel like the black sheep, and it can create frustration. Parents don't do that. Thirdly, parents can provoke their children by depreciating their worth, by not giving them value of worth. Many children feel that what they do is not important and my parents don't care, unwittingly or intentionally, just out of cruelty and certainly sinfulness, is that parents can communicate to their children that they are not significant and don't have worth. We all have worth because we're made in the image of God. And so parents can do that by little things, by not valuing what they say. Sometimes kids are right. You never listen to me. You never listen. You might hear words, but you never are listening and engaging what I'm saying. And that can create a discouragement and create a withdrawal of the child. Parents should value their children and express that and show that and say that. Fourthly, parents can provoke their children by setting unrealistic goals. Sometimes I remember when my boys were younger, going out on the ball field, soccer field, whatever, and there are times you wondered if the parents were kind of living their unfulfilled sports dreams through their children. Well, sometimes they can set unrealistic goals. Now, good, healthy provoking of right goals is a good thing if it's done in a healthy way, but just to set up these unrealistic goals for children can lead to frustration. And sometimes children have been led to despair and sadly even taken their own life because of this unrealistic expectation that if I cannot perform to my parents' expectation, they won't love me. And sadly, many kids, as they grow into adulthood, they transfer that on their view of God. So life is constantly a performance. They perform at work because they were raised to perform at home. Their parents really expressed love when they did well. And when they didn't do well, they knew they were not valued. And I think, again, you can have a balance there. You can show them, no, it's important to get good grades, but what's important is for you to do your very best. If your very best is a C+ and a B, and that's your very best, then that's okay. But give your very best. I'm going to push you to do your very best, but I'm not going to be unrealistic in my expectation there. So you get that. Number five, parents can provoke their children by failing to show affection. You know, sometimes people say, well, I was raised that way. My father never showed me affection. Well, you know what? Get over it. Change. Quit using that as an excuse. Stop it. Show affection to your kids. Maybe when they're teenagers, they don't want you to kiss them in public. But you know, you can put your arm around them. You can tell them you're proud of them. You love them. Show affection to your kids. And quit using what happened or didn't happen as you as a kid as an excuse. That's just lame. So get with the program and show right affection to your kids. Number six, parents can provoke their children by not providing for their needs. And so certainly that will vary economically, but children should have safety and security of a home and shelter and proper nutrition and all those things. So by not providing their needs, that is one way that can frustrate. And I mean, not providing their needs when you have the means to do it. Now, just because they want $200 Nike shoes, that's not necessarily providing for their needs. Let them work, get a job, cut grass, save their money, and they can buy those on their own. But I'm talking about when it's within your means and you're just maybe a tightwad or stingy, you know what? Get over it. Provide for your needs for your kids. And I would even say, give them some of their wants every once in a while. It's not going to kill you, parents. All right. Number seven, parents provoke their children by a lack of standards. You know, and part of this too is kids who are raised by parents who grew up in the 60s, sometimes just kind of an anything goes mentality. Well, I want to give them their freedom. I want them to explore life. Give your kids some healthy, right standards. There are some things that are acceptable and there are some things that are not in our household. I'm talking about when they are in your household. Now, when they move out and they're on their own and they're providing for their own needs, well, then your influence is change. But as long as they're in your home, put some standards out. But as I said earlier, don't make it so unrealistic. Give some give and take. We know they want to come in at 1, work on a compromise, 11:30. In other words, meet sometimes kids halfway. Number eight, parents provoke their children by criticism. I mean, nothing is ever good enough. Anything they do, it never matches your expectations. I love this quote because of the truth of it. I think his name is Haim Gnat. It'll be on the screen. A child learns what he lives. If he lives with criticism, he does not learn responsibility. He learns to condemn himself and to find fault with others. He learns to doubt his own judgment, to disparage his own ability, and to distrust the intention of others. And above all, he learns to live with continual expectation of impending doom. Are you like that? Because you had such critical parents, maybe a mother, a father, somebody, a grandparent, aunt, an uncle, you know, somebody that was just always critical. It was never good enough. And so even when you did your best, you always felt like, you know, it was junk. I know I'm gonna catch it because it wasn't good enough. And so sometimes parents can provoke their children by this type of criticism. Number nine, parents provoke their children by neglect. All these negatives are neglect. And you know, really sadly, David, as great a man as he was, the Bible says he was a man after God's own heart. But yet we see he had some real big time dysfunction in his own family. Absalom. I think a lot of Absalom's problems, we don't want to over-psychoanalyze between the white space of the of the verses, but certainly there was some dysfunction big time going on in his kids, and Absalom is one that was came to my mind. David was indifferent to him, and Absalom felt that, so Absalom felt like he had to kind of prove his worth, and it led to his rebellion against his father and against his rule, and led to civil war in the nation of Israel. Eventually, it led to Absalom's death. Parents need to be involved in your children's lives. Do you know what your children are learning in school whenever that gets back online? Do you know what they're learning? Are you engaging? Do you know what they're watching? Do you know what kind of movies they're watching? Do you know what they're looking at on their smartphone? Listen, you have control over all that, and you need to be engaged in that kind of parental way. But just sitting down, maybe taking them for ice cream. I used to try to take my two boys for breakfast every Friday, and to stay engaged. I talk to my children at least a couple of times a week, text or verbal talk, because I want to know what's going on in their life, and we need to be engaged with our kids. The last thing is parents can provoke their children by excessive discipline. This is the parent who I would say is more abusive in their words, emotionally, physically. They're abusive. That is wrong. Not only is it wrong morally, and certainly the Bible doesn't condone abuse. The Bible talks about disciplining your kids, but that's not abusing your kids. And sadly, some children have abusive parents. And if you trace the timeline with their parents were abusive. I mean, statistics, and I think the history shows that a person who was abused as a child, verbally, emotionally, sexually, physically, whatever, oftentimes it's a greater risk that they will become abusive. So excessive discipline. You know, you may say, you know, men, you're just a big macho guy. You run a tight ship. Well, you're a dictator, and people fear you in an unhealthy way. And you need to let the Holy Spirit soften you up a little bit. You may have been a military man, but the home is not a military. There might be rank and order, but you know what? You're not in the military anymore. And so you just being able to be the big intimidator and be the disciplinarian in a harsh way, you are provoking your children. You are an unhealthy parent, and you need to reconsider and let the Holy Spirit, if you're a believer, if you're not saved, then you need to first of all come to the Lord Jesus Christ and submit to His leadership. But if you're a Christian, you're a believer, you may need to let the Spirit work on you and rethink that is whether you're excessive in your discipline. Now, mind you, just because kids might complain that you're too harsh, that doesn't mean you are too harsh, but you get the idea. So parents often say things to their children they would never say to anybody else. And that familiarity breeds contempt, and that often, sadly, happens in the home. So the influence of parents is great. Paul says, look, being that you are in Christ, Colossians 3:3, your life is hidden with Christ in God, you're full of Jesus. Well, let that be reflected. Wives, husbands, children, and parents. Next week, we're going to look at what the Bible talks about masters and servants, masters and slaves. That was a part of the Roman culture, and we'll talk a little bit about that. In our modern day, it would be more of the how we relate to our employer, employees, whether we employ people or we are an employee, how that those roles take place. Notice the Christian life affects everything. The Christian life surrounds our whole identity, and we should reflect Jesus in all of our identities, in the home and outside the home. I love the Word of God. It's very practical, and we'll pick that up next week. So thanks for joining us on our midweek Bible study. Hopefully it's been helpful. Check down in the comment area below where this video is on YouTube. And I posted something I didn't have time to read, but it's a very helpful thing that I think you may find helpful. Check it out. God bless you. Have a great week, and join us next time.